In 1973, a tall, skinny 17-year-old getting out of high school in San Antonio had a choice of three colleges on which to select for his Naval ROTC scholarship. He selected the University of Texas at Austin. He majored in journalism, but he was, from the beginning, focused on wanting to be the most physically fit and the toughest mentally as well as physically of his classmates. He wanted to be a Navy SEAL. In 1978, there were very few of them. Detachments, one on each coast. It was a very demanding regime to undertake. Back in those days, we still thought mostly of military conflicts, of ships fighting one another, or of tanks, massed armies posing one another. Bill came along when we were moving into an entirely different world, where we would end up dealing with irregular warfare, dealing with terrorists, some state-supported, some independent. In those days, the prospect of a very successful career meant that he would be a commander or maybe one of the two captains in the SEALs. But as the nature of warfare changed and its importance to our national security became more evident, the field expanded and the opportunities grew. To get to be a one-star was pretty remarkable. But he moved on from that stage in 2003, National Security Council staff, on to the Joint Special Forces Operation Commands, and eventually to be its commander. Along the way, moving on to a third star. We had a breakfast here at an NROTC reunion time a couple of years ago, musing about how remarkable to get to that status and how unbelievable in both our fields that one could ever have the chance of four stars. He earned his by being a leader in an emerging field of warfare. He is a warrior leader. Even as the three-star commander, JSOC, he still went on night raids with his troops so they could see a visible leader. He now has the top command for Special Forces.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great honor to introduce to you Admiral William McRaven, United States Navy.
Admiral, thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Well, please, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Admiral, an honor to meet you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here today. You have so many admirers, obviously, in the audience, but not just here, all across Texas, all across the country. Every single person in this state of Texas is so proud that you're a native of Texas.
Thanks.
Thank you so much. Really.
Thank you.
For everything you've done. Admiral, a former commander who knows you said he's physically tough, he's compassionate, and he can drive a knife through your ribs in a nanosecond. This causes me to wonder about my questions today. So if I say anything that offends you, I apologize in advance.
At least it's not Sam Donaldson interviewing me, so that's
good. Well, you dodged a bullet. Perhaps I did as well. So let's go back to the beginning. You grew up in San Antonio, as Admiral Inman said. Your father was a fighter pilot in World War II. You came to UT Austin again, as Admiral Inman said, on a Navy ROTC scholarship. And you walked onto the UT track team as a long-distance runner. And indeed, you received a degree in journalism in 1977. I think you chose your career better than I did. In a sense, your current position today started back when you were part of the ROTC at UT. Can you go back in time and tell us your greatest takeaway from the UT ROTC program?
Yeah, well, first, it's great to see these young midshipmen over here. And I tell you, I would offer a round of applause for these folks who are signing up to do the nation's business. Well done, guys.
What do you remember?
I think, Sam Donaldson hit on it. What you learn in the military is discipline and leadership and teamwork. The great thing about the ROTC program is it allows you to learn that over the course of a four-year period. So they start you off, reasonably small. Yeah. You get a small squad, as we used to have back then. So you got four or five guys, and you're learning the basics of leadership. And you're learning it from guys, in my time at least, that had been Vietnam veterans.
Yeah.
So we had Marine gunny sergeants. I had the colonel, Marine colonel at the ROTC unit, was a very decorated Marine from Vietnam. So you learn leadership at a very young age, and they start you kind of small and begin to build. And by the end of my 4 years, I was fortunate enough to be what we called the battalion commander at the time, so yep. Had the opportunity to lead the entire group of not only the midshipmen, but we had a naval enlisted science program, enlisted men at the time that were there as well. So tremendous opportunity. I think the other thing that the Naval ROTC unit allows you to do is to learn to fail. And frankly, I think we all go through life and we have those failures, and if you don't learn how to deal with those failures early, you're gonna have problems. And the ROTC unit, part of this leadership is try it. If you fail, get back up on your feet and keep moving.
Move on. It's a terrific lesson. I ask you about something you said to the Alcalde Alumni Magazine. You said, I was able to sit in on lots of political science classes, and the education stimulated a lot of thinking that you just don't get in high school. There's nothing quite like the university experience to force a young man to mature quickly, and the university certainly did that for me. Explain. What do you mean by that?
Well, my university experience wasn't so much what I learned from the School of Journalism, although that was important, and we did a lot of writing, and I think I learned to kind of craft my thinking well. Yep. But what the university experience taught me was how to deal with people. I mean, you come away from home, and while admittedly I was only an hour and a half away from home, you still kind of break those ties, you begin to live on your own. You have to deal with people. You have to deal with problems. You have to deal with professors. You have to deal with your seniors, and then eventually your subordinates. So the university environment allows you to do all that in a little bit of a protective cocoon. So I think that my takeaway from the university experience was just learning to deal with people as you're going to have to in the real world.
Well, specifically on the journalism part of this, you've also said, I tell people that a journalism degree or an English degree are two of the most important degrees you could have coming into the military. I guess there's hope for us after all. Can you speak specifically about the connectivity between your journalism degree on the one hand and your career in the military on the other?
Yeah, absolutely. The one thing you do, or what you do a lot in the military, is you write briefs, you present briefs. So you've got to be able to take your thoughts, your ideas, and put them down in a very concise fashion.
Yep.
So the piece of journalism, and we learned a lot about how sports writers wrote their stories. And that was always kind of considered the gold standard, frankly. Learn how the good sports writers write and try and make your story along those lines. So as I began to write reports, you take out things that are extraneous. You know that you have a certain amount of space you can use. So your reports had to be good. And then as you go on to brief, and part of the School of Journalism was I was briefly in a radio, television, and film class. So you have to learn how to present yourself in front of a camera or in front of an audience. And these are skills that I think everybody needs, but certainly in the military was a skill that has served me well.
Absolutely fascinating. Okay, so personally, you've been married for more than 33 years, and in fact, your wife, Georgianne, is here today, Mrs. McRaven. May we ask you to stand and let us acknowledge you, please? And you all have three children, and you've said that the best thing the university allowed you to do is to meet your wife.
Absolutely.
The university.
Well, what else would I say?
Well, that's a good...
I mean...
You're a wise man, Admiral.
That's why we've been married almost 34 years.
Even admirals have better halves. I like that. The University of Texas, in that respect, forever changed your life. Can you tell us your story of how you met your wife and given your perspective about what it means for a spouse and specifically your wife to be a partner in your service to the world?
Well, we met, I was a senior, she was a sophomore at the time. The ROTC program, and I'm not still sure whether they still have, we had a kind of a little sister's program that were called the Anchorettes. And she had been part of a sorority, and as I understand it, in order to gain points in the sorority, I don't understand the point system, but in order to gain points, if you did more social activity, that you got more points. So a friend of hers invited her to come to the ROTC to meet the midshipmen, and so we met there, and it wasn't before long that I knew that she was the right gal for me, even though she was a few years younger.
And she got her points.
And she got her points, absolutely. And actually, if you married a midshipman, you got a whole lot of points.
Wow. So that was, glad to know it worked out well for both of you. That's actually great. Let's get right to the more recent work that we've all come to know and admire and respect you for, and that is the aftermath of 9/11. Let's go back to that day, sure. September 11th, 2001, when the Twin Towers fell. You happened to be in bed recovering from a parachuting accident. Can you talk a little bit about that particular point in your life as a Navy SEAL and the path that followed?
Yeah, I was a Navy captain at the time. I was in charge of all the West Coast SEAL teams. Yeah. And as was mentioned earlier, you know, in whatever leadership position you're in, you have to get out with the troops. You have to show them that you're prepared to share their danger. So part of this was free falling out of an airplane. We were doing it in San Diego. In the course of the parachute jump, the guy below me kind of pulled up underneath me, or I slid over him, which is not a good thing to have happen. He opened his parachute at about 4,500 feet. I realized that I had to maneuver very quickly. His parachute kind of came up and hit me in the face. I spun off, and I opened my own parachute, not knowing exactly where I was in terms of altitude.
And you didn't know how far above
the ground I was at the time, because when the parachute hit me, it kind of momentarily dazed me. So I pulled my ripcord. Bad news was the pilot chute opened up or wrapped around one leg, and the risers around the other leg. That was bad news. The good news, bad news was it opened. And when it opened, it essentially just kind of cracked me in two. So I was hanging upside down from the parachute and managed to ride it to the ground. So I was in rehab for a month or so, not rehab, but I was in a wheelchair for a little while and then on crutches, and was kind of living in my house in a hospital bed when 9/11 happened.
Yeah, it's a horrible story. You are the principal author, Admiral, of President Bush's National Strategy for Combating Terrorism. One of its central messages was, we will not triumph solely or even primarily through military might. So from your perspective, you've seen this stuff up close, is the best way for us to fight terrorism by stealth or by conventional warfare?
Yeah, I think it's even more broadly than that. The one thing I think we understand as military folks is, you know, you can't kill your way to victory, certainly not in an insurgency or not against violent extremism.
Yep.
Sometimes you have to go out and capture or kill the enemy in order to buy space and time for the whole government approach to work. But whether it's in Afghanistan or Iraq, at some point in time you have to get to, and I hate to use the term root causes, but you have to be able to provide the folks an alternative to violence. So in some cases in Africa, they need fresh water. The women need education. I mean, there's a whole host of issues that you have to address if you're going to address violent extremism. Unfortunately, sometimes the whole of government doesn't work as quickly as we'd like, and therefore you have to continue to fight to buy space and time for all of government to work. But the point in the original National Strategy for Combating Terrorism was we understood back then, one, you have to allow the host nation to deal with its own security problems. In the end, the Iraqis and the Afghans and the Malians and wherever we happen to be, they're going to have to be able to deal with their own problems.
Yeah.
We can't completely buy into that and invest in it in the long run. So that's what a lot of special operations is. It's teaching them to deal with their own problems.
Now, we mentioned earlier in the program, and may have in fact mentioned it within the last couple minutes too, to remind people, not that they need to be reminded, this is the anniversary of the raid that killed Osama bin Laden. This is the 1 year anniversary this week. Put up that photo, please, the famous photo that we've all now seen so many times. The one in the Situation Room, everybody's watching the monitor. And it is the first anniversary of the Abbottabad raid. It's kind of an amazing photo, isn't it? I mean, I know Brian Williams did a report from inside the Situation Room this week. You were in charge of the raid.
I was.
The military side of it that took out Osama bin Laden. I know there's a limited amount that you can say, so let's lay that over this, and we acknowledge that there's some things you can say and some things you can't say, but I can't resist the opportunity to ask you some questions about this.
Sam would be proud of you.
He would be proud of me. I'll be nice about it. For months before the raid, Admiral, you were developing various proposals for the strike on the compound. And we've heard that there were various options that were considered. But when the time came, you commanded the helicopter assault. What insight can you shed about any of that?
Well, I've kind of made a point of not talking about the tactical aspect of the raid.
Sure.
But there's a couple things I'm happy to tell people.
Yeah.
First, the Central Intelligence Agency, and at the time, Director Panetta, but the Central Intelligence Agency was absolutely magnificent. And one day when the story is eventually told about how those agents, those case officers that were working for the CIA, got to the point where we at least had an inkling of where bin Laden was. That story in and of, itself is incredibly compelling. And Director Panetta, recognizing that there's always been a little bit of a tension between the CIA and the Department of Defense. But when I first met Director Panetta in 2009, well before this, I had an opportunity to sit down with him and his senior leadership. And as I was kind of introducing myself, I looked around the room, and every one of his senior officers I had spent time with in Iraq or Afghanistan or Nairobi or Yemen, somewhere we had spent time together in the past, you know, 9 years. And this trust that we had built up between the CIA and the Department of Defense, frankly, allowed us to move forward on a whole variety of fronts that, you know, most people don't, still don't know about. But Director Panetta's leadership, if you've seen him, what you see is what you get. He's incredibly gregarious. He is a team builder. He is never looking for any credit for himself. It's all about the team. I mean, a great leader. And consequently, when we began to pull the plan together in January timeframe, and he came to me and began to fill me in, yep. I mean, we had already established a strong partnership, a strong relationship. So when you look back on this, while because of the sensational nature of the SEAL raid, the SEALs and frankly the Night Stalkers, who were the helicopter pilots took us in, get a lot of the credit, the reality of the matter is the credit, most of it belongs to both the CIA, and the second part of this is the President of the United States. Now, I'll start by saying I am completely apolitical. I worked for the Bush administration, National Security Council staff for 2 years. Right. I very much enjoyed working for President Bush. But what you need to understand is what your president, the commander-in-chief, did during this time. Again, we started in the January timeframe, and as a very small group of folks were involved in this, eventually what we call the principals, so the Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and others, Director of CIA, obviously came together to look at how we were going to conduct this operation. I can tell you there was no rancor amongst the principals. There was no egos. There was no hidden agendas. There was just great Americans trying to do the job. And the president, I have said repeatedly, was the smartest man in the room. He had incredible leadership. And I think this is the amazing thing. Again, Sam Donaldson mentioned, you know, he had not been in the presidency that long. He came into the presidency without being kind of fully prepared for it. But as a military leader who's been doing this for 35 years, a lot of that in combat, watching him take the advice and counsel of his kind of subordinates, if you will, the various secretaries, listening to the military piece of this, and managing over a four-month period of time to cull out all the right questions about, you know, the risk that we were going to assume, and then at the right point in time to make the decision and to have faith and confidence in me and my men is a tremendous credit to his leadership. So however you feel about politics, I can tell you that your commander-in-chief did everything you would expect and more, and not just him, but again, the entire national security team. Very impressive. So for whatever that aspect is worth.
It's worth a lot. Let me, you actually briefed the president in real time by secure video while this mission was progressing. It seems like it must have been an incredibly tense time, and in fact, the photograph that we had up earlier, people focus on Secretary Clinton with her hands over her face. I think we all would feel that sort of sense of, I can't believe this, and what's going to come next. Was it as tense as it appears to be? Again, without revealing anything, yeah. You can't reveal. Was it as tense as it appeared to be?
Well, again, some things that, it's a little bit like, I'm sure, as the people saw the video there. There yeah. are people jumping out of airplanes and guys fast roping out of helicopters, and to folks that don't do that for a living, it may appear to be incredibly daring or, you know, something along those lines, but this is what we do. I have done thousands of raids. So between Iraq and Afghanistan, the one thing that we had to, that I had to kind of convince my guys was, because I handpicked these guys yeah. For their experience, was we had done thousands of these. The helicopter pilots that were chosen had done thousands of these, yeah. Not a dozen, not a hundred,
thousands.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, it was certainly a little bit more tense. It was a long flight into the target. Obviously, things didn't go exactly as planned on the target, But we had rehearsed all that because that's what we do. Yeah. The nation expects us to not only have plans, but backup plans, plan A, plan B, and plan C. And we had them all.
And you did.
And so the tension that was felt elsewhere was not felt where I was, because we had a job to do. We were doing the job. And again, when the helicopter went down, we had a plan, a backup plan to deal with that.
That's
so,
it.
No, I did not feel the same tension, but I can absolutely understand why it was felt in the sitting
Somebody
room.
Else would. At one point, according to the accounts of that event, one of your men on the ground contacted you and said, Geronimo, E-K-I-A. Can you decipher this for the civilians among us here? What did that mean?
Well, I think it is in the open press. I mean, we have a checklist. And Geronimo was the name for bin Laden to let us know that we had gotten bin Laden, and EKI is enemy killed in action.
Yeah.
So the report back from the field was not only was it bin Laden in their estimation, but that he had been killed in the action.
How'd you feel? It seems like such a mundane question to ask, but when you realized that you and your team had accomplished this thing that had been a goal of the world and of the nation for all these years, that you had actually done it, how'd you feel?
I was too busy worried on getting them out of
getting
the country.
Getting them out, right. Well, I understand that. Yeah. Okay.
But, yeah. You know, I also tell folks it's orchestras don't follow you around in life. Yeah. They do in the movies.
Right.
You know, you see a period building and the timpani drums begin to, pound a little bit and there's tension and there's something going on in the background. That doesn't happen in real life.
Right.
I mean, people make decisions with a lot of things going on without that sense of, history. And again, when the call came through, I relayed the call and had to get back to getting these guys out of Pakistan unharmed.
Right.
So, again, it focused on the job.
Well, amazing. Now, to Admiral Inman's point about the stars, last summer, I want to be sure people here know, for your exceptional service to the country, you were awarded a fourth star and were made head of U.S. Special Operations. Congratulations, Admiral. You've said, Admiral, that there are various points that change the trajectory of our lives. For me, it was really the University of Texas. It put me on a path to be commissioned as a naval officer. The university taught me the great values of standing on my own, dealing with the pressures of being a student, prioritizing commitments, and dealing with the complicated and diverse situations that are part of growing up and maturing. I got a magnificent and broad-based liberal arts education. It's great to hear that UT's investment in your education has had a transformational effect on your life and a return. It changed your life, and you ultimately, through your work on May 1st of last year, changed ours. That's why you were named Texan of the Year last year by the Dallas Morning News. That's why you were a finalist for Person of the Year in Time Magazine. I think if all of us could vote on those two things, we would say you are our Person of the Year, Admiral. So thank you so much for your service to the country. UT is enormously proud of you. We all hold you in the highest regard. Ladies and gentlemen, Admiral William McRaven. Thank you
very much.
An honor to meet you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.